We already managed to discuss triads, tetrads, or actually n-binds. And so to remind me, so these are actually the co-n-binds. But in principle, you can imagine them as being giving you a frame on every orthonormal frame on every spacetime point. And so given these n-binds, you can reconstruct the matrix via this equation. And of course, you can rotate this frame around with SON rotations without changing the matrix, which just basically the matrix just comes from contraction of these n-binds. So what you will get is an SON freedom. And as a remark, it's actually a very subtle issue. It's not really that the space of matrix is completely equivalent to the space of n-binds, even in the sense that, you know, after taking care of this issue. So the point is that typically what you would like to require from a matrix is that the determinant of this matrix is non-vanishing, and then one speaks of a non-degenerate spacetime. Here it's a bit a question whether you should require this, and classically you might not care about that, because classically you could say I just consider solutions where this does not happen. In quantum theory, you, however, have always to define basically, you know, if you, for instance, go to the path integral or even canonical quantization, you always have to define the space of variables you integrate on. And, you know, the integration space, like the set of E's. And here you have to make a conscious decision whether you want to integrate over E's, which always satisfy this requirement or not. And it's an issue which is not completely settled, to say that, for instance, in the path integral approach. And maybe we will encounter that issue again. There's also something which we will see later at the end of the course, that there's an issue with the orientation freedom coming in here. Okay. So it looks quite innocent, but actually it leads to some important points in quantum theory. And so we have these n-binds, and they come with these internal indices. And since I hope you know a bit about gravity, I actually hope you know what a connection is. And so usually you should have encountered at least the so-called Levi-Civita connection, which does something for you because it does connect, tell you how to parallel transport a vector along a path to v prime mu. And so you generalize basically the conditions you would like to hold from flat spacetime, from a parallel transport of a vector to curved spacetime. And to this end, you would have been supposed to know what, you know, this, what this Levi-Civita connection is, which I will call gamma nu rho. And so I hope you remember the conditions which specify Levi-Civita connection uniquely. Okay, thank you. Indeed, so it's torsion free, which means that the lower two indices commute, and metricity, which means that the covariant derivative apply to anything which involves the metric is actually zero, which allows you to pull up and down indices freely inside these covariant derivatives. Okay. So now we have these new objects, or these new internal indices, and what we basically need is a spin connection. And this will be called omega j mu k, and the associated derivative, which, so we have nabla, and this will be called capital D, d mu, which basically does the same thing for these indices as the Levi-Civita connection does for your spacetime indices. So at some point, you know, we basically define, assume we have these objects, omega j mu k. So they come with these two internal indices, and mu tells you it's a covector of one form. So in the end, it will transform as a one form with respect to spacetime diffeomorphisms. So and here you basically you apply the same rules as for nabla. So if you want to differentiate something which comes with an internal index, you define that to be the partial differential applied to psi j plus the spin connection coefficients contracted with psi k. And so you know, as is also the case for the Levi-Civita connection, if you have something with an index down, you actually write something like this. And we will say that we will see that this makes complete sense. later on, we will derive a condition for this and see that there's a certain antisymmetry in the indices. And say, you know, so if you have 10 of these indices, you basically have to add 10 of these terms and so on. And if you have mixed terms, you do pluses and minuses and whatever. And so if you have mixed indices, well, you basically add the corresponding connection things. So we here we have a plus omega j mu k v k nu plus gamma. Actually, it's a minus now. Minus mu nu. Okay, so basically these are the rules that tell you how to define this covariant derivative with respect to the spin connection once we actually specified omegas. And so now the question is, how do you specify omegas? And so the modus changed. So we have to think, you know, how do we compute omega? How do we define omega? And you want to make it compatible with the Levi-Civita connection, which is a metric, and satisfies this condition. And so if you write G nu rho in terms of the E's, we get basically this nabla. I mean, we have to replace this nabla with the covariant derivative applied to the field binds. So what we actually require as a compatibility condition is that this covariant derivative annihilates our tetrads. And so you can basically write out the definition of how this d mu acts on these things. And so this is basically given. Okay, I already wrote it. Some other form here, so this is given by d mu a d nu. Then you have a plus omega g. So you want this to vanish. And basically, you need an equation which gives you omega j mu k without this ek nu. So what you do is actually you apply the inverse field bind here and get an equation for the omegas in terms of a nabla derivative of your field binds. So if you write that out, the definition of nabla this is e nu k gamma rho mu nu e j. So this gives you basically the spin connection coefficients. As a function of the Levi-Civita connection. And the triads. And so this basically this condition, this relation comes basically from this metric compatibility of the spin connection. Okay. Of course, you can also invert this equation, which I'm not going to do, and you get gamma as a connection as a function of omega and e. But what we will need is at some point an understanding of basically omega as an independent object. So what we have to ask is, what are the conditions on omega so that this relation, which gives me gamma omega gamma, the Levi-Civita connection, as a function of omega and E, is actually Levi-Civita. And as we reminded ourselves, it's basically the Levi-Civita connection needs to be torsion-free and metric. So what we will again find is that we need to satisfy also for omega that it's actually torsion-free and metric. There's a funny twist, however, as you will see. Because it will turn out that the metric condition for omega is actually related to the antisymmetry of the indices, which comes from here, which is here actually the torsion freeness. And the torsion freeness is a condition which involves the derivative. So there's a funny twist in these things. And again, it's kind of a subtle point in counting kind of, you know, the 3 degrees of freedom, which you start with. So the metric condition, you know, is basically that this term vanishes. And if you write this out and apply here, this condition of omega in terms of the Nabla derivative of E. So here you apply the Nabla derivative to these two terms. And this gives you basically some antisymmetrization of omega. And you apply this Nabla derivative to G. And this vanishes because of metricity. And so what you find is that you get here omega mu jk minus omega mu kj.
Grand derivative for n binding zero.
Why? So basically, you want that this d mu is compatible with gamma, and so that you get the same results from applying d mu from gamma. And so for Nabla, you know, you basically have this metricity condition. And so one thing is that you apply you write G as in terms of your field binds, and you get one condition. and you could say, okay, this however is a contracted equation, you know. And we will see that, you know, the uncontraction is actually the torsion freeness condition. So basically, it's actually that this part was, I mean, this part gives you really the connection of omega in terms of gamma. And we will see that omega, if you express it in terms of this gamma, and gamma used to be metric and torsion free, this omega will be also metric and torsion free. And now I'm basically arguing the other way around, because we will basically need to specify to find out what are the conditions on omega to be metric and torsion free. However, these will be, you know, automatically satisfied if you compute, if you compute omega by this equation from gamma. It just, now we have this equation. We could have found omega by actually first saying that we need it to be metric and torsion free, and then we could have found omega as a function of the triads, for instance, which gives you a loan. Actually, I will notice that in the end. So it's a bit involved, but it's basically just this part you can actually a bit throw away, but it gives you this formula in one step. Whereas if you derive here omega from E, actually I'm not going to do that, but I tell you that you can do that, but it's a lengthy exercise. Yeah.
I think there's, no, on the right. Right, yeah, right there. There's an extra row and some U's.
Yeah, good point. Yeah. Okay, so this is metricity is actually anti-symmetry. You know, so omega mu jk is omega mu kj minus. And then we had torsion freeness. And again, it's a bit, involved. Basically, what we want to do is to express the torsion in gamma. So assume gamma has torsion in terms of omega. And to this end, we, however, use this equation. This tells us that this has to be zero. Let us write this. Okay, so I applied basically the definition of d mu on these field lines. And so you get, you know, for each term here, you get one of these terms, one term with an omega and one term with a gamma. And this last term with the gamma, this is defined to be the torsion in gamma. So if your gamma would not be torsion free. This would be something called the torsion tensor in these indices. And then you contract with this E rho j, which is not supposed to do much. It just changes the indices from spacetime to internal. So if you want this to vanish, this has to be vanishing. And so you basically define this left-hand side to be the torsion of the spin connection with the right whatever sign you have. So we define this torsion tensor of the spin connection. And in terms of the torsion of the gamma, which is now because it has torsion, not really Levi-Civita. It's given by the contraction of the antisymmetrization of gamma. But we will need this torsion object. And for for friends of differential calculus, you can write it abstract. It actually means that this is the one form derivative, but with the connection omega of your one form omega of your one form eg omega. So it's a covariant derivative of these one forms. And this is the derivative of forms, so it's always antisymmetric, and that explains the antisymmetrization here. So torsion freeness is, of course, that the torsion vanishes, as you can guess. But note, so here we had basically an algebraic equation on the gammas, and that gave us torsion freeness. And here we have an algebraic equation on the omegas, and that gives us metricity freeness. And here it's actually not a derivative. So here we have an equation which involves the metric, and you have gamma appearing somewhere. And here you have, which gives us metricity. And here we have the torsion, and it involves the derivative. And you get torsion freeness. And so there's actually, I didn't tell you, but there's two different first order formalism for gravity. Actually, I don't know what the other is called. I think it's called the gamma-gamma action. So you could, in principle, write a first-order formulation where you use Levi-Civita connection as a free variable. In this case, however, you actually demand that gamma is torsion-free because you just say it's it's not really a tensor, it's some object where these two indices commute, but you don't demand that it's metric. And what happens is there, it's that one of the equation of motion gives you metricity of gamma. We are going to do it the other way around for the spin connection. So we will actually assume that omega is antisymmetric. But we will not assume in the action that omega will be torsion free. And so that's why we needed to go through this exercise. So basically, antisymmetry now is for omega is an easy thing to implement because it's just antisymmetry. And so we will use that. Okay.
I have a question.
Yeah.
Wrote down the action anyways, would you not get it as an equation of motion in that case?
No, you get the equation of motion, as you see. You get the equation torsion freeness as an equation of motion from the action.
You can't get the metric compatible with the equation of motion because you...
No, I think then it doesn't turn out with the number of degrees of freedom. And
so it's similar to when you do the gamma-gamma action, you have to impose the
symmetry. I don't know if you have, because I never tried to impose it, but... It's basically the standard stuff. I don't know if you can actually do the other way around, because one has to count how many degrees of freedom you have and how many equations you need. And so that's, you know, the two formulations. Okay, and then there's a complicated procedure to actually get omega just as a function of E, which you can basically read in the script by using the torsion freeness condition, this one, and the antisymmetry, and you can get omega as a function of E, and it's a slightly lengthy formula. Okay. So this point about that we basically use that omega is antisymmetric and torsion free, we will need later on if we go to the action. But for now, what we need is that if you remember, the action was something like R menu, G menu, square root of g, and then there was some integral. So we can guess what is g menu and the determinant of g in terms of the triads or tetrads. But what we will need, of course, is R menu in terms of the triads and the spin connection. And so we have to go through another calculation. And yeah, I'm slightly lazy today, so I tell you the idea of this calculation. So you could, of course, make it very lengthy and express your Riemann tensor as a function of the gammas. And you all know this formula by heart. And then you express gamma as a function of these omegas by using this equation, and then, you know, you write everything out, and then you get R in terms of your omega. However, there's a shorter way, and this is, if you remember, again, you know, what this Riemann tensor actually means. And if you remember it, I hope you know that, it's something about the non-commutativity of your Nabla derivatives. So basically, you use this definition of R. And then you basically express V rho. So you write this again. This is just the normal bracket here. In terms of your components in your triad n-bind. And so now, you know, you apply separately these nablas, which you, of course, have to turn into Ds on these components. and go through some equations, and you will find in the end. So it's all very straightforward. And it's quite similar, actually, how you derive R just as a function of your gammas. And so the structure is very similar to the gamma, to R as a function of the gammas. So you have this two derivative coming acting on omega, which come from this derivative acting on this derivative, and the exchange of these two things. And then you have two terms which are quadratic in the omegas, which is basically the same for the Riemann tensor expressed in terms of your Levi-Civita connection. So this term, derivatives of omega and so on, this will be defined to be the curvature, which will be called f, because it's very similar to the electric magnetic force field. And so we have these, oops, this works out, all these indices. F mu nu jk, jk. So all these indices can pull up and down again with the internal metric and the space-time metric, of course. And now I will just in this corner, basically, so now we have the Riemann tensor in terms of your curvature, which is a function of omega. And so all what you have to do is basically moving some indices around. And so, of course, this is quite straightforward modulo the 10 signs, which depend on your definitions of what you mean with Riemann tensor. So here I actually also wrote down the definition I use for the Riemann tensor. So I'm not sure other sources might use other definitions. If you ever check any calculation that basically defines you know, what kind of indices I have, because sometimes it's the other way around with, I think, these two pairs of indices. Okay, so we have this equation. And this will allow us to express the Einstein-Hilbert action, in principle, as a function of omega and E, and as I told you, at some point it's just important to declare what are your independent variables. So in principle, you could now, even if you express it as omega and E, you could understand omega as a function of E, and then you would get another variational principle, because your action would be only a function of E, but it would not be a first order action. Was also. And you could do that actually in different dimensions. And so as an exercise, you can do it in 4D. And since I'm lazy, I do it only in 3D. And in 3D, we can save some indices by this trick which we just had actually yesterday. So we basically we have this omega mu, and sometimes it comes with these indices jk. And as I told you, we basically will impose that these are antisymmetric. And so in 3D, again, you know, an antisymmetric, there are three antisymmetric pairs of indices which run from 1 to 3. So we define mu L as epsilon. These spin connections which have only one index L by being by this equation. And likewise, we define for the curvature tensor. And apparently, if I'm not wrong, it comes with a funny internal sign. I hope I'm not wrong, because you put this index here in the middle. So basically, the idea is that every antisymmetric pair of indices, you could basically turn into one index via this epsilon sign. And we do it, however, only with this internal epsilon, because if we use the spacetime epsilon, that's not a tensor, but it's a tensor density, and then it gets a bit more complicated, which you might have discussed or are going to discuss in some tutorial. Okay, so basically now we can rewrite all these terms, the torsion and so on, in terms of these epsilon of these terms, which use the epsilon trick. And later we will see that this simplifies basically introducing SO3 indices, because now we just have one index. And this will be at some point an SO3 Lie algebra index. And the SO3 Lie algebra is actually the same as the SU2 Lie algebra. So that's one reason to do it. I'm slightly confused with my. Apart from saving saving in the number of indices. So you express basically now everything in omega L mu and F L mu nu. And so again, it's a not very enlightening calculation. So this is what you get from this equation here. And you have an epsilon which comes from this epsilon.
Question? Mm-hmm. So if you said the omega L and U are objects of a Lie algebra, what's the product rule? Or what's the, how do you define the product of like omega L and omega K?
Uh, this I come later to that because this is not just a product, it's an anti-symmetric product. So F here is a D kind of D omega, you know, the partial derivative as this exterior derivative applied to omega as a one form. And so here you have this anti-symmetrization. And this anti-symmetrization basically allows you to everything express this Lie algebra stuff in a Lie bracket. So this is all handled in this Lie algebra valued forms in principle. So that's a good question, but you can take care of that. and I'm not sure whether I want to go through that because it's basically expressing everything in these more abstract terms. And it's, of course, this equation looks slightly shorter than this equation. But then in the other, you know, it's basically in components, it's basically always this stuff. Okay. So there's one subtle point here. And this is this subtle point. And apparently now I really have to speak about the Levi-Civita tensor. It's also, so this is the Levi-Civita tensor, which is has nothing to do with the Levi-Civita connection. So the only thing which I want to tell you is that this is something now, you know, which is basically what you hopefully know as a Levi-Civita tensor. And I'm going to write twiddles on top of that so that you remember it's actually not a tensor. But it's a tensor density. And so tensor density is a tensor multiplied with some determinant of your metric or the square root of the determinant of the metric. And you need to remember that because it's that these tensor densities, you know, they transform slightly differently under space-time diffeomorphisms, but the only change which you have is that you multiply under transformations everything with the corresponding determinant of your coordinate transformation matrix. And you get that, you know, the simplest tensor density you can think of is a scalar density. Which is square root of that G, and it's a scalar. I mean, it looks like a scalar, but it's not a scalar because a scalar would basically not transform really under space-time diffeomorphisms or only just change the point. But here you can figure out from how the metric changes now. Let's see whether I actually manage to write this. So if you use this, then now I have a bit of missing things. You can also figure out how that G transforms, and you will find that you need to write a determinant of your transformation matrix, and you can figure out whether it's the inverse or this determinant. But I guess it's just this one. And so here, for the scalar density, you get this factor here. And so every time you have a density or an inverse density, you not only have to transform these indices, but also multiply with this determinant. And I don't know if you know these kinds of tricks. So this is just no. So here, what I used is the representation of an inverse of the matrix. So here I have the inverse triad, or so this was called the co-triad at some point. And these are the triads, and these are inverse to each other. So what I used is that for any matrix, if you have this equation, you can write the inverse of a matrix in terms of using completely antisymmetric epsilon tensors. And you might not know it with the epsilon tensors, but you know this equation from the presentation of the inverse as whatever it's called. Linear algebra, determinants of submatrices. Let's call it this because it's basically the two. Minus? No, there's. I think there's a minus because of some index ordering, but there is no minus. I'm always Euclidean. I mean, in this part, yeah. So I'm in general trying to write some the indices in correct order, but yeah, typically I'm Euclidean.
Also, can I ask a quick question? Why did you switch the order with how you you defined f jk there and then omega jk? You sort of switched the order of the epsilon symbol down there where you're contracting on L?
Here.
Yeah.
Yeah, I hope it's correct, but if I switch it, it's because to be compatible with some standard literature. You know, that's basically not a deep reason. So it's basically just a question of definition. And I think, yeah, you can check it, or I could check it. it's basically that I didn't use that. If you express everything, I hope this is it's consistent. So what you want is basically the same expression for f, which looks similar. And I guess I had to do that to get the same expression. But since I've written that last year, I don't really remember. So I had to do that, but I think that would be the reason that you want basically this equation to hold.
Right. You can get that just by multiplying your definition by the epsilon symbol, right? And so that's why I thought they should come in the same order. But
so maybe it's the other way around. So I try to check at some point. So here it's a bit question mark. JK. So if it's this, then it should be the other way around. Check. Where do we have F? Yeah, then it should be actually this. Okay. So we have this. This thing, and let me just R in terms of the thing. And so this allows you to express square root of G. So square root of G would be related to just the determinant of E, because E is basically something like the square root of the metric. And if you put everything together, then you get a minus sign, which we are going to forget mostly. You get finally the Einstein-Hilbert action in 3D as a function of E and F. And very nicely, it nicely separates into E and F, which is a function of omega and only omega. So we will basically use that. And we will start with this expression in the next section. And actually, that is almost the most computational intensive part of the entire lecture. But you can already see here that it's extremely simple to derive one of the equations of motion. Because now I told you we will understand the triads as independent variables and omega as an independent variable. So omega is not a function of E. Omega is just some funny object, which doesn't need to be, you know, we don't even need to say anymore that it's antisymmetric, because we already put it into this antisymmetric form here with these epsilons. So omega is just some tensor with two indices, and F is defined to be this function of the omegas. And so if I vary with respect to E, I just write the variation here, and I get an equation which is F is equal to 0. So basically, you know, depending on how difficult you find to conclude that 3D gravity is about flat connection, here it's really, you see it immediately. So we will find as one of the equation of motion, and this is the equation of motion which varies the triads, that F is equal to 0. And so the other thing you have to vary is these omegas. And you will find if you vary with respect to omega, you can kind of guess what you will get. So this term with F includes derivatives, so you have to partially integrate and so on. And if you partially integrate, you throw your derivatives on E. So you have some E's, and then you have some terms which are quadratic in the omegas. And so what you will find is actually that the torsion has to be 0. So as I told you, you know, we don't assume torsion freeness, but we will find it as an equation of motion. And yeah, I guess it's really something, it would be good for you as an exercise to check the last equation. So you have to partially do some partial throw these derivatives on E and figure that out, and check that you really get this torsion freeness. And so we get basically that we have to quantize the space of solutions, which is about flat and torsionless connections. Okay, which actually nicely finishes one of these sections. So this was basically most of the classical part. And we will make a short recap next time. So basically, we will start from this action, which is basically something which is E veg F. It's just E veg, yeah, E veg F. It's almost like a Q dot P. So in a sense, it's a simple action. And look at its symmetries, actually. And then go on and do a canonical analysis of this action. Okay, so if there are no other questions, we'll see each other tomorrow. Thursday. Okay, thank you.